Today we'll be talking with Brianna Crowley of Texas A&M Viticulture, and you are a fungal pathogens specialist.
I've been working with fungal pathogens for 12 years now, and then perennial crops for about 8.
Your job is really to advise commercial grape growers on sort of how to really make things work and maximize their production?
Yeah, I'm kind of a niche, right? I'm a plant pathologist who works with horticulturists, so I have to kind of master a little bit of column A, a little column B, and in that I go in and I'm a plant doctor. I tell people what's going wrong and how to fix it, and then we work forward together.
So we're going to talk about something really deep and dark today, pathogens, and let's just start with, what is a pathogen?
It can be a viral, bacterial, fungal, or pathogen. Yeast sometimes can be pathogens. But it's kind of like how when we get sick, we have an immune system, it fights it. Plants also have an immune system.
Right.
It works a little bit differently, but there are receptors and effectors. And when a pathogen that's actually virulent for a host that's susceptible interact, then you get disease if you have the right environment. We like to refer to what's called the disease triangle, where you have a host, pathogen, and an environment. And if all three of those perfectly come together, that's when you start to see symptoms and everyone starts calling people like me.
So you get all the scared,
I do.
Frantic calls about what in the world is going on.
That, and I'm the doom and gloom lady. It says like, oh, it's this. Sorry, can't do much about it now.
What are some of the most common pathogens we see in Central Texas, if there are? There aren't common ones. They're more ubiquitous.
Oh no, there's a lot of ubiquitous ones that are fairly common in home growers' gardens, as well as in specifically for grapes. Things like downy mildew, powdery mildew, in grapes, black rot is one of our biggest ones. We also get Pierce's disease, which is caused by bacteria instead of all those other ones are fungi.
Right.
Viral diseases are pretty common. We're just now really getting the detection methods that we need to find those. But that can be in anything from vegetable crops to your backyard tree fruit to, you know, a commercial orchard or vineyard. It's downy, powdery, maybe some of the root rots. Cotton root rot is pretty prevalent in the hill country. Rhizoctonia, Pythium, Phytophthora. Pretty much if you can get infected with it, it's here. Which is not great, but it's because we have such nice warm weather all year round just about. And, you know, we have enough moisture here in the center of Texas that we do tend to get some heavier infections in, say, high plains. We also have it better off than the Gulf Coast because they have more moisture, higher humidity, and encourages fungal growth.
Are some new, or are these ones that have really kind of been around? You'd mentioned with the viruses, we're just sort of being able to detect them. I mean, what's the story sort of on that, the backstory, so to speak, on these pathogens?
It's a big question. So for a lot of the pathogens, they co-evolved with the plants that we have around here. In some cases, like with blackberries, black raspberries, there is a set of viruses that they can be infested with, show no symptoms whatsoever. You put those right next to red raspberries, which have not developed those receptors to cue their immune system to kick in the action to fight it, they're gonna die, or at least be very, very sick. And so it's a sort of coevolution between those two, where if they've grown up with it, and like phylloxera is not a problem for native grapes here because they were always here together. One learned how to fight the other. Now when someone took Texas roots over to France, we almost killed their industry, but luckily we also saved it. So,
you know,
trade-off, I hope so. But that's why we graft all of our grapes around here for the most part, that it's easier to deal with the native pathogen by using a plant species that has co-evolved with it.
So that brings an interesting point. I'm a native plant person. It sounds like, you know, again, the coevolution things being, that makes a lot of sense. A lot of these, it seems like, are varieties that are being affected more so than, you know, native plant communities per se. I mean, it might be in there, but you're not seeing to the detriment of those populations.
That's very true. That fits exactly with the point I was making. The other thing is that a lot of, say, weed species or, you know, native species that are out there that are right next to where your garden or your orchard or whatever is, those can be alternate hosts for these pathogens. So they might have they might be infested with the pathogen and they won't show any symptoms. Whereas you get, a susceptible host like a cucurbit or something in your garden, it starts flourishing, the plant starts growing, all of a sudden you've got downy mildew, but that's because it's been hanging out in other species right nearby.
Right. So I went to recently a wheat growers association, and I was really shocked to see that they're listing among their plants of like eradicate from your fields were eastern gamma grass and western wheatgrass, which are all things that I love and use in my projects. But again, I'd never seemed it framed as how sort of that worldview of if you're in food production or farming, that those are looked at as negative because they can carry over some of those pathogens.
Absolutely. One of the first things I tell new growers is, get rid of those wild grapes that are right there. I know they look really pretty next to your vineyard, but they're danger zones. They're hotbeds for Pierce's disease and all of these other things that can infest. And so you're just welcoming, essentially. I don't care how tight your spray program is. It's not going to stay away.
We talk about the pathogens. We've talked about the plant disease triangle. So that's sort of this perfect storm, so to speak. So where you might have infection. Once a plant gets infected, does it ever go away? I ask this because I think, even with human ailment, we tend to think of we can treat it and but that's really not the case for a lot of that. So I'd imagine even with plants, I mean, if something's there, some of these pathogens are there and can continue to be a problem.
Right. For instance, with perennial crops in particular, you get a virus, it doesn't just go away. You have that in the system because it's a systemic pathogen.
Right.
Same thing with most of the bacterial diseases we get. You can crown gall. I once had a woman tell me, honey, you can use kerosene on that. And I thought, what are you going to do, light your vine on fire? You're going to get rid of the gall, sure, but you're not getting rid of your pathogen.
Right.
It's still in there.
Right.
Now, for things like fungal leaf and fruit spots and things like that, yeah, absolutely,
sure.
There are treatments out there. And there are organic and conventional methods, and some of those are more effective on either side than the other. That's a conversation for a whole nother day.
Sure.
But there are options for most of them. Things like cotton root rot, we didn't have a treatment for until very, very recently.
Right.
All that work was done here in Texas. We now have a special licensing to use a systemic treatment you put on once a year, and you don't have to really worry about it. And that's one that will kill your vines in a week.
It seems like those are solutions, but are there any collateral adverse impacts?
Yeah.
You're putting this out, and there's a lot of beneficial microbes that are potentially being affected by these treatments as well.
That's true. I had to fight that dragon when I first started this position because I came in thinking, we can do biocontrols or something like that here. I got a reality check my first year working in grapes. There are a lot of pathogens and insects out here that if you don't keep them in check, you're not going to have a crop.
Right.
So the unfortunate reality is, and what I like to tell people is instead of shooting for let's not go full force conventional, let's not go full force organic and say let's not treat it at all.
Right.
Let's shoot for sustainable.
Right.
We want to target the pests that are involved at that moment in time. We want to target the insects that are going to harm our harvest, which I don't like to spray for insects very much. That's just my personal opinion because most insects are good and they work themselves out. I like to think you should treat, but be smart about it. You have a mite or two, you're not going to get hurt. If you have a lot of mites, you're going to ruin the photosynthetic capability of your plants for that year, and you're doing some serious damage. It's all about finding that economic threshold that also fits with the ecological health of your garden, orchard, vineyard, etc.
Preventing all of this in the first place is much easier.
It's so much easier. Unfortunately, that's not always something that's doable. It's something you can strive for. You can make sure that plants are well watered, that they don't have frost injury, you're facing the weather, so you can't really control that, but you can prepare them for winter to be a little bit better, whether that means mulching at the end of the year, whether that means just making sure they're well watered going into dormancy. You can make sure that your spray program is tight if, you're in that sort of danger zone in the spring when things get wet and warm and fungi come out. You can make sure that, you know, your pruning wounds are covered and clean. You know, there's a lot that you can do ahead of time. But once you really start seeing symptoms, we're kind of in the treat and live with, or treat and let it go.
One last question. When the fungal apocalypse occurs, can I reach out?
Absolutely.
Wonderful. Well, thank you so much, Brianna, for coming with us. It's been very educational today. Next, Daphne will be up and down to earth.